Good evening. My name is Etta Loria, and I'm a member of this church as well as its church board. I would like to welcome you today to the historic Manhattan Seventh-day Adventist Church. Thank you so much for joining us this evening to celebrate the life of Anthony Romeo, who we fondly call Pastor Tony. I know you came from many different parts of the country, so thank you so much. We are drawn here together by the bonds of our mutual love and respect for Pastor Tony. This evening, as we remember him and reflect on his life, may you find comfort and healing in knowing that his life will continue on in our memories. So for now, I'd like to, if you allow me, to introduce Pastor Andrew Harewood to invoke the prayer.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Maya Angelou once said, "Mom, family, you'll forget what a person may tell you. You may even forget what a person may do to you or did to you, but you'll never forget how a person made you feel." Tony was a difference maker in my life personally, and I'm a better person because of him. One of my favorite poets, M. Hubbard, he said, "Character is so largely affected by associations that we cannot be indifferent or even afford to who and what our friends are." He says, "They write their names in our albums, but they do more. They make us who we are." And then he said, "Be therefore careful in selecting them, and once wisely selected, never sacrifice them." I'm glad our paths have crossed. I'm a better person because of him, a better pastor because of him. There's a lot of unfinished things that we had, but God knows what he's doing. Let us pray. Almighty God, indeed, this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice even with heavy hearts and be glad in it. Tony was the real deal. And as he sleeps away in your voice, we have the confidence that when the trump of God is sound, and the dead in Christ is raised first, he will be in that number. We ask, O God, that you would comfort not only his immediate family, but his hurting church family, and all those who have come to pay their respects. May we be reminiscent that a drop of rain does not make a hole in the ground by violence, but by often falling. And that was Tony's attitude, to embrace all people, to love and respect all people. And so, God, when the question was asked for him, as we talked so often, what is required of us, he pointed us to Micah, where your word declares, "Do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly before you." And so, God, in the stillness of this moment, with heavy hearts, but yet with a sense of assurance that we will see him again, wrap your arms of love and mercy around every person that is here, but in particular his wife and his two children, and remind them that indeed you are still with them. Come now and be with every participant, every person, every listener. Be with every musician, every aspect of praise as we remember this servant. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Good evening, everyone. I want to thank all of you for coming here this evening to express your love and support to the Romeo family. Your presence here is a tribute to Pastor Tony Romeo and the legacy he has left behind. At this moment, I would like to ask all staff and workers, pastors of the Green York Conference, please stand up. Thank you. You may be seated. On behalf of the Green York Conference, we would like to express condolences to Pastor Tony Romeo family, to his wife, Marlene, his daughter, Jennifer, and his son, Anthony Jr. Jennifer and Anthony, I can tell you that I know you feeling now. Just today, 1 month ago, my father passed away. But like a Tony, my father was a good leader. And I hope to see you very soon, not only my father, but also Pastor Tony Romeo. The love of the loved one is probably the most difficult time in life. The truth is that we live in the world that has loss and pain and problems. But I have a good news for each and every one of you today. Very soon, we will live in the world where there will be no more pain, where there will be no more family problems, and where there will no more death, because we will be in heaven with Jesus, our dear Savior. The Bible does not tell us no grief. It is say if a Christian die, we don't grieve as those who had no hope. We have hope today, not wishing, but knowing two things. Number one, Tony is resting in Jesus. And number two, we will see him again. I know that God understands what we are feeling. The Bible says that Jesus was a man of sorrow. And also know that in our own ways, in the times like this, we all need the same thing. Comfort, rest, hope, and peace. All these things are found in Jesus. I believe that Jesus is coming soon, and I strongly believe that he is also the resurrection, because the Bible said, John chapter 11, verse 25, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believe in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Sister Romeo, Jennifer and Anthony, you will continue to be in our prayer. On behalf of the conference, greater your conference, I would like to ask all our workers, staff, membership, please continue praying for Romeo family. May God bless you.
It is my honor to pay tribute to Pastor Tony on behalf of the historic Manhattan SDA Church. Pastor Tony had been our leader since August 2011 until his passing. His appointment as our pastor was a sweet homecoming because 40 years earlier, he started his first ministry here as a young man, making this church his first and last home church. There is so much to say about Pastor Tony or his ministry, but I will only give you a few insights this evening. Two words best describe the focus of his ministry: Christ's love. While his sermons certainly talked about love, his actions spoke louder than words. He had a way of making everyone felt loved and accepted, and inspired us to do the same. His sense of humor brought us laughter and joy. For every young at heart, our young people and many others found a kindred spirit in him. Pastor Tony had a passion for the community. He had a tear and a prayer for every woe he read or heard. In a gesture of love, he opened the church doors to a number of self-help support groups that made an impact in the community. Currently, 15, 12 step programs call this church their home. A lover of great music, Pastor Tony used our church as a venue for what he called concerts for peace that brought people together and promoted goodwill in the community. He also encouraged this church to support various community services that benefited the homeless, the battered women, families torn by immigration issues, and other programs and counseling services to help needy New Yorkers. We will surely miss this remarkable person who showed us how faith works through love. We love you, Pastor Tony. We love you, Marlene. We love you, Jennifer and AJ. And we continue to pray for you. And I would like to introduce Ichi Shimada, who is our church organist, and he will be playing a piece by piano.
Hi, my name is Chase. My grandfather, Anthony Joseph Romeo, or as I call him, Poppy, was born on September 4th, 1948, to Giuseppe Pietro and Anna Romeo. Anthony was brought home from the hospital to a loving home in the Bronx that included his grandmother, Maria, and his two older siblings, Teresa, who was 13 years old, and Vincent, who was 10 years old. When Anthony was 3 years old, his mother, an accomplished organist and pianist, suddenly passed away. His sister, Terry, who was 16 years old at the time, left high school to take care of her two younger brothers. Poppy often said that Aunt Terry became like a mother to him at that point. The family was members of the Bronx Italian Seventh-day Adventist Church, and this became Poppy's extended family. Poppy had glaucoma in his right eye, and at 15 years old, he had to have it removed. Before the operation, he drew an arrow under the eye to be removed, just to make sure the doctors didn't take the wrong one. Anthony was known as a shy kid, but Aunt Terry and others saw he had an ability to draw. So when it came to high school, he applied to and was offered the opportunity to enroll at the High School for Art and Design right here in New York City. His father passed away when he was 18. He briefly lived with family members, but was offered a small room at New York Center, right in the heart of Times Square, where he lived for many years. Poppy continued to follow his love for art and design by going to college at the School of Visual Arts, or SVA, on 23rd Street. Later in life, he would teach advertising classes at the same school. In addition to a passion for art, he also had a love and passion for God. He decided to enroll at Atlantic Union College in Massachusetts to pursue a degree in religion. After college, he moved to Washington, D.C. area, where he worked at the Review and Herald and served as a young youth leader at Sligo Seventh-day Adventist Church. During this time in the Washington, D.C. area, he loved visiting the monuments, museums, and going to the Kennedy Center. He enjoyed his time there, but New York was his home, so he returned to pursue a full-time career in advertising. When he got back to New York, he met a beautiful Marlene Gonzalez, I call her Mimi. After two or three dates, he declared that he was going to marry her. Luckily for him, she felt the same way, and on July 4th, 1976, they got married in this very church. Exactly 11 months after they got married, they welcomed their first child, Jennifer Ann. 3 years later, my dad, AJ, was born and completed their family. Mimi and Poppy had both grown up in the city, but they decided they wanted to have their children grow up surrounded by grass and trees, so they moved out of New York City and into a town north of the city. Poppy had a successful career in advertising. He served as an art director, vice president, and group creative director for great advertising companies such as Doyle, Dane, Burnback, Lord Einstein O'Neill and Partners, Scally McCabe Solves. He began in his advertising career when he was hired by Bill Burnback at Doyle Dane Burnback. In the video tribute, you will see a few of his famous commercials. In 2003, Andrews University in Burn Springs, Michigan, awarded Tony the honorary degree in Doctor of Fine Arts for his work in advertising and his positive influence on students and society. While working in advertising, he also served God as a lay pastor for a number of Seventh-day Adventist churches. In the 1970s, he served at this very church. In the 1980s and 1990s, he served at Yonkers Church. In the 2000s, he became a full-time pastor at Advent Hope on the Upper East Side. In the 2010s, he became a ministry entitled Reach NYC and returned to this church as a pastor in 2011. Over the last 50 years, he was a guest speaker at many churches and schools, speaking to young people about his personal experience with God and his experience in the advertising field. Poppy welcomed my mom, Allison, into the family in 2004 when she married my dad, and was excited when Chase, that's me, and my brother, Hunter, were added to the Romeo family. Poppy thought that I was funny and loved that I was caring and sensitive. He loved that the both of us had a passion for sports and loved that Hunter and I enjoyed cooking. He loved Hunter's drawing and creativity. Poppy enjoyed spending time with family, serving as a pastor, helping other people. He also enjoyed drawing, gardening, food, nature, animals, music, the Yankees, and making people laugh. Poppy was funny. He always had a joke to make people laugh. He would tell Hunter and I that he used to play for the Yankees and Knicks. When I was younger, I believed him. But as I got older, I knew he was joking and it made me laugh. He came to our games, concerts, and variety shows. One of the last good memories I had with him was when Nana, Mimi, and Poppy came to my championship basketball game. At my spring concert, we sang songs by the Beatles. During the song, All You Need Is Love, Poppy started to cry and said, "It's true, all you need is love." In addition to my family, Poppy's survived by his mother-in-law, Nursa, his brother and sister, brothers-in-law, many nieces, nephews, and their spouses, partners, and children. We miss you and I love you, Poppy. Thank you.
Mr. Jarrell Gilkison, he is the superintendent of schools at the Atlantic Union Conference, which is our mother organization for the church, for the Adventist churches in the Northeast. He has a letter that has been sent on behalf of our union president, Dr. Jill Knight.
It's my pleasure to be able to share with you some of the broadness and deepness of Tony Romeo's ministry. We would be here all night, Jennifer, if I shared all the people that have asked me to say thanks. I won't do that. Tony had a tremendous impact worldwide. My wife presently is in China ministering because of his ministry, allowing to participate in that. And the North American division has sent greetings. And they send their condolences. And they want you to know how much his life has meant to the life of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Dr. Knight and Yvonne Knight wish for me to read this to you, and it's my pleasure. On behalf of my wife, Yvonne, our family, and the Atlantic Union Conference, I express our deepest condolences to Pastor Tony Romeo's wife, Marlene, and their children, and other members of his family. Pastor Romeo has rendered faithful service to the Greater New York Conference and by extension the Atlantic Union. He distinguished himself in his work for God, especially as he served at the historic Manhattan Church. His leadership was made even more visible through the New York 13, known as NY13 Initiative, as he hosted the evangelistic series conducted by Elder Ted Wilson, the president of the Seventh-day Adventist World Church. Only eternity will tell of the full impact
of the dedicated service given by him for so many years. Pastor Romeo has fought the good fight, he has finished the race, and he has kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for him a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to him on that day, and not to him only, but also to all who will love his appearing. May the God of the resurrection continue to bless you with his peace and comfort as you maintain hope in the second coming of Jesus Christ. Yours in the Master's service, Dr. E. G. Earl Knight. God bless each one of you as we pray for this dear family. Thank you for letting me be able to share this letter. Thank you, Adelino. Thank you, Albreas. And thank you to each one of you that will keep his ministry in this community. May God bless you.
Tony was a very good friend. Although it was work and ministry that made our paths cross, it was the kindred spirit in him that made a sincere friendship flourish. I remember when I first met Tony some 10, 11 years ago, and I was immediately blown away by his impetuous yet kind and passionate heart. He reminded me of someone very similar and very dear to me, my own father, and I knew from right there and then, Tony's loving what you see is what you get, modus operandi. That was Tony. As he proudly would say, he was an Italian from the Bronx. We had in common many things, and especially our love for pizza. You could kind of tell in my case. And the curious fact that our respective heritages, involvement in organized crime, he's Italian and I'm Albanian. We would converse over the phone on a constant basis, at least once a week. Either he or I would call each other up and chat. Our conversations would range from ministry ideas and brainstorming to discussing his most recent Facebook post and whether it was appropriate at all. Every time he would finish the conversation with, "I love you, man, be well," and insisting to go out to grab a bite. Tony gave so much to this local church, to all of the other churches that he pastored during his ministry. And he gave so much to the Greater New York Conference of the Seventh-day Adventists. He had a great vision for ministry, love for God, and passion for people, any and every one of them. That's one of the things that made Tony special. He was inclusive, he was loving and welcoming to all people from all walks of life. He treated well and loved even the crazies. Love without borders truly encapsulates the spirit of Tony Romeo. We, his friends and colleagues in ministry, will terribly miss him for his friendship and camaraderie, for his vision and outside-the-box approach, for his unsettling spirit to do what was right, ethical, and Christ-like, for his creativity and leadership in ministry. Marlene, Jennifer, AJ, Allison, Chase, and Hunter, I know you'll miss him terribly. And I know that the lonely nights will be there to haunt you. But be comforted in knowing how blessed you were to have had Tony in your lives. How much blessed we all were to have had him in our lives. His legacy carries on, and his memory will be cherished until the day when we see him again in the morning of resurrection. That was Tony, a friend, a minister, a grandfather, a father, a husband, a brother, a child of God, an Italian from the Bronx.
I have only one question for you. Do you know what this is? This is a smoked mozzarella. And if you don't know what this is, then we can't even have a conversation. This was the true bread that came down from heaven. Not like your fathers ate and died, you know, the stuff from Worthington. If anyone eats of this manna, he shall live forever. Those are the words of my friend here. And you see the sound of laughter? That's the presence of God. He understood that. He was enthralled by that. That was the way that he enabled the healing to take place in the world, that God was able to touch people through him. And somehow I have an insatiable desire to kiss this mozzarella, but I have to resist. But it symbolizes a lot, because we really did share a lot of these. And we're still here. I'm still here, at least. I'm surviving. But, you know, Tony, even to the very end here, I got to tell you a little story. We were told about, you know, him coming home from the hospital right into hospice. And so Bloody and I, we had made a visit. Little did we know, as we made the visit on the Thursday, that he would pass away 15 hours later. But there he was. Marlene and AJ and Jennifer were in the room, and I brought my guitar. But I came in the room, I sat down, and I said, what can I play? I played the love theme for The Godfather. It's gorgeous on the classical guitar. It's a beautiful, it really does sound beautiful. And as I struck the last note, I could see he was really enjoying it. And the door knocked, and Bloody came in. And it was a very tense moment as the door opened up, you know. It's like, you know, Tony was laying in the bed with Marlene and everybody. It was a very somber moment. And, you know, he just gingerly and sheepishly came over, and I moved aside. And he went over and he kissed his forehead. Very, very loving thing to do. A nice Albanian man here. And I told him at that moment, no, that's improper. You got to kiss his hand. And I saw Tony's face all of a sudden, you know, that distress just melted away, and he actually smiled. It was a beautiful, blessed moment and memory that will stick with me for the rest of my life. And we brought some comfort. We had prayer, and it was a very special time. I don't know what else to say, because, you know, a man that was, and a friend that was so involved with my life on a weekly basis. Of course, I can go on and talk for hours and would not even scratch the surface. But I will just simply say that it is a big loss for all of us. We lost a very unique personality. Someone who was not afraid to say what we all thought at times, but he said it. And he had great insight. He had great love. He had great love for his family, his wife and grandchildren, his daughter-in-law, his lovely daughter, of course, son. What could you say? He had love for the Manhattan church. He transformed you guys, you know? He came in here, you must never forget, you live in the most progressive city in the world and one of the most progressive neighborhoods in the world. And he came with all of his expertise and all of his know-how from his advertising years, concerts of peace, 12-step groups, Reach NYC, counseling, and he taught love without borders, love without labels, love without seeing beliefs and doctrinaire positions to identify and to separate us and to build walls. He came to, he broke those walls down. Love without borders. See people for who they are. Don't worry about changing them. You can't change them. You got to love them. God changes people. That was his message, and that's the gospel. And that's the message that we will all continue to hold on to as we hold on to his memory and as we enjoy some nice smoked mozzarella.
That was pretty remarkable. Amen is right. My name is Joe Nunziata. I've known Tony for 40 years. I want to thank Marlene, Jen, AJ, along with Allison and his grandchildren, all of you, the love of his life, for allowing me to be a part of this celebration. Okay, here we go. I called him Toto. He called me Nunziata. It wasn't like a first name like Nunziata. I'm Nunziata, he's Toto, for 40 years. Tony was more than just a man. He was more than just a husband and a father and a brother. He was more than just a preacher, a teacher, art director, and stand-up comic. Yeah, he did do that, you know. Tony was a drug, a good drug. A drug stronger than any other pharmaceutical the FDA could ever approve. A drug more impactful than any scientist could ever create. The name was Tony Romeo. That's the drug, one name. Tony Romeo, right? It was an anecdote that had one purpose and one purpose only: to make people feel better. According to the FDA, the scientific name Tony Romeo, now I looked this up, one word, it's applied medication for the purpose of achieving a state of well-being characterized by emotions ranging from contentment to intense joy. The generic name, if you want to know, is Tony Romeo. But everybody's always concerned about side effects. You know, drugs have side effects, got to watch those. Well, in some cases, again, I looked this up, in some cases, it's been known that strong doses of Tony Romeo can make you a little nuts, a little uncomfortable, a little bit uneasy. You see, telling people the truth often does things like that. Suggesting to people to stop doing things that may be bad for them and to others are often hard to swallow. But in most cases, quantitative medical research has shown that continued use of Tony Romeo, particularly on a daily basis, has caused severe laughter. And I mean severe, resulting in increased blood pressure to the head, pain in the small arteries of the scalp, and muscle tension in the face and neck. There's also shortness of breath that often occurs. And of course, the most common side effect of Tony Romeo, I'm sorry to say it, but it is incontinence. It is. Don't laugh. If you're going to see him, you better bring a couple of Depends. He was a very funny man that made you feel better with laughter. Laughter until it hurt. Quick story. So I'm on the phone with him at home one night. I think it was at the kitchen table. And I start laughing. Typical conversation with him. I start laughing. I start choking. I start banging on the kitchen table to catch my breath, right? And then my wife, Fran, walks by and says, "Oh, tell Tony I said hello." She knew. Tony made people feel better. Oh, and made people better. Remember the expression growing up when you scraped your knee and your parents would bring out the Mercurochrome and get a Band-Aid and say, all right, there, you better? You better now? You better? Well, that's Tony. He made people feel better and made them better. All right, Madison Avenue. This is the part that a lot of you guys don't know about. This is the other side of Tony that I knew. We worked as partners for this great agency called Doyle Dane Birnbeck, as Chase said. You were terrific, Chase, by the way. Boy, you have your grandfather in you. Man, oh, man. We worked together for 10 years at Doyle Dane. I remember the first day we met. I was 25, he was 28. A lot of commonalities we found out. I said, hi, I'm Joe Nunziata. He goes, how you doing? Tony Romeo. Where are you from? I said to him. He said, the Bronx. I said, Brooklyn. Great. He was first-generation Italian-American, with his parents coming from Italy. I was second-generation. My mom and dad were born here. But like me, he and his pals grew up in the streets playing stickball, stoop ball, and a game called Ring Alivio. Like me, he loved baseball and adored the New York Yankees. And hey, it was 1977-78, the Bronx Zoo, with Billy Martin, Thurman, Reggie. What a time to be a Yankee fan. It's incredible. And also like me, he could recite every one of the 32 episodes of The Honeymooners. Right, with Ralph Cramden, Ed Norton, remember? And we also, both of us, love to eat. Yeah, we'd love to eat. It was love at first bite, we used to say to ourselves. Oh, thank you. Mostly, those are my sons laughing. They never laugh at what I say. Mostly Italian food. Tony would always remind me, Nunziata, yeah, Toto. We taught the world how to eat. But occasionally, you know, he was very ubiquitous. You know, sometimes, you know, hard Jewish salami on rye coated with two sides of Kosciuszko mustard and a cream soda was a nice little pick-me-up that got us through some long nights and tough deadlines at the ad agency. Talent-wise, Tony was a brilliant advertising man. You have no idea. Yeah, you have some idea. Reached New York City, and you have no idea. Not just good, not just great, he was brilliant. A brilliant art director, a brilliant strategist, a brilliant account person, a brilliant presenter, and even a brilliant writer. Now remember, in advertising, there's an art director and a writer team. He's the art director and I'm the writer. But no, he was also a brilliant writer. And I was supposed to be doing that. But he wrote too, and everything he did, he made me better. Remember Tony Romeo, the drug? He had to make you better? When we had an assignment to create a TV commercial, a print ad, he immediately dug for the truth of the product or service. While everybody else around was looking for something clever to say or something, oh, that's quippy, that's a pun, that, no, 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 no. Go for the truth. He would remind me, Nunziata, you're from Brooklyn, I'm from the Bronx. Who knows the truth more than us? He made me dig and find the truth. Then since we had the same sense of humor and we liked the same things that were funny and fun, there always seems to be in a honeymoon episode or baseball or one of our neighborhood experiences slip into our TV commercials. It wasn't luck. That's what we were and that's what we did. And when it came time to present to our creative directors at the agency, those were our bosses, and then onto the clients themselves, those were the agency's bosses, they always seemed to want us to present. And what a show we would put on. We were Cramden and Norton, Laurel and Hardy, Martin and Lewis, all wrapped up in one. While I would present the story, Tony's one-man orchestral talent, his trombone mouth, you know his Tony, okay? He would provide the background music. This is true. This is what we would do. I would say, like, say, for instance, here's a commercial. So imagine yourself on the pearly white beaches of Hawaii, Tony. Brr, 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 brr. I would continue. But you're overcome with a surge of thirst, Tony. Brr, brr. Then I would continue. Then suddenly a tall, cold, frosted bottle of Yoo-Hoo chocolate comes to the rescue. Brr, 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 brr. Then look. Psst. Ah, Contentment. Paradise. Client would laugh. They'd approve the commercial. Next day, we'd be on a plane to another tropical island for 3 weeks shooting a TV commercial. Which, by the way, that was the trick. Every commercial we had, Tony started the first frame with a palm tree in the TV storyboard. We're not stupid. The Bronx and Brooklyn, you don't mess with us. Yeah, sure, we won our share of advertising awards and turned into the madmen of Madison Avenue. Neither of us drank, by the way. In fact, this is off script, but I didn't drink to begin with. I was afraid that I might be stupid, you know. But Tony never drank because he knew it was no good for you. I remember one day we're in the Breakers in L.A. doing a commercial, and I felt like having a vodka tonic. You know, we were with the directors and everybody in the crew. Yeah, I'll have a vodka tonic. You know, yeah, vodka tonic. And Tony goes, "Rrp, there I am. I'm flying solo tonight." Rrp. That was a great story. I'll never forget that. Thanks for reminding me about that. We never forgot where we came from. Two Italian kids from the boroughs, always finagling. We were always finagling. You don't know that part of Tony. Pastor Tony, God bless Tony. You know, he was a finagler, all right? He was a spell finagle, all right? He was a finagler. For instance, here's a good for instance. Remember, what are we, 25, 28, 30 years old? Here we go, all right? Now, during the good old days, they'd give us something like 2 weeks to do a TV commercial or a print ad. 2 weeks is a long time, but it was luxury. You know, it was the golden days of advertising. Yeah, take 2 weeks. Me and Tony would do 4 or 5 storyboards in 2 days. And what would that mean? We can finagle for the rest of the time. So what would we finagle? We love baseball. We love the Yankees. And it was, like I said, it was a great era. Sort of like the one they had in the 90s, but this was in the 70s. So we finagle our way to get press pass credentials onto the field at Yankee Stadium. Him as a photographer and me as a writer. Now, all the time, all we wanted to do was get to Yankee Stadium and get autographs. That's all. But no, let's do this right. Let's do it right. Okay. The first time was the best. We knew that in order to get press credentials, we needed to represent a media outlet, like a magazine or a newspaper or a TV station. So Tony says, "Let me think." You know, he says to me, because always honest, he says, I do contribute sometimes to this Seventh-day Adventist magazine called Insight. You still remember that, Insight? So I go, "Insight? The hell is Insight?" No, Insight. I contribute to Insight. Okay. So maybe we can do, so I'm figuring this out. Yeah. We'll do a story on religion in the Major League Clubhouse. Okay. Yeah. So we call up the Yankee PR department. Hello? Yeah, this is Tony Romeo. Oh, it goes into his voice. Did you ever go into his voice with you? Yeah, this is Tony Romeo. Photographer and my writer would like press credentials, please. The New York Yankee game. Blah, 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 blah. Oh, he mumbled too. He never mumbled with you guys. He'd always mumble with me. So the PR director gives out the credentials. Says, "Well, what's your media outlet? Who are you writing for?" Insight magazine. Insight. You want press credentials for Inside Sports? See, at the time, you know, like Sports Illustrated, there was a magazine at the time called Inside Sports. It lasted for around 2 or 3 years. It was very popular, but it just ran out of advertising. But it was very popular. So the guy asks Anthony, he says, "Mr. Romeo, that's Inside Sports?" He goes, yeah, it's Inside. Okay, Inside Sports, yeah, Inside. He wouldn't lie. He just kept on repeating Inside. And the guy at the other end, like everybody else, Tony makes you crazy. He goes, all right, Inside Sports. Sure enough, we get the credentials for Inside Sports. And before you know it, right, with all his mumbling, we dress up for the part. We get into the club. We get into the Yankee Stadium. Now, there are different sections when you get your press credentials. Well, do you want the clubhouse? Do you want the dugout? Do you want to be on the field before the game? Do you want to go to the press room after the game? do you want to be in the press box? And Tony's answer was, oh, yes, 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 yes. So we got all seven credentials. He was definitely driving the guy crazy. There was no question. So we did it. We got our pictures. We got our autographs. We had the time of our life. It was the beginning of a great scam year. I think we did it like two or three times until it got smart. And then we said, oh, no, no, we always said inside. By the way, we're still working on the story. We'll get it to you. But being a successful lad man wasn't enough for Tony. Nah, he couldn't stop there. He had to take that talent of his and share it with others and make them better. So at night, Tony taught at the School of Visual Arts for years. I don't know if you knew that. For years, he taught at the School of Visual Arts at night, his art school alma mater. And throughout the years, he inspired hundreds and hundreds of young art directors and writers, teaching them the craft of honest and smart creative advertising that truly makes a difference, truly. His classes were always closed out, by the way, by the first week. He was closed out. I mean, think about it. His reputation. He was crazy, he was funny, and he was brilliant. I couldn't even get in there if I wanted to. Little did he know that this was the precursor to his stand-up comedy gigs that would happen years later. So as an instructor of advertising in the School of Visual Arts, Tony Romeo, the drug, made his students feel better and made them better. Tony was famous, as I mentioned, for his human trombone. It came in handy, by the way, during presentations at our TV commercials, as you know. But also, little did he know that he would be the world's first audio emoji. He really was. Because, you see, when words were not appropriate, Tony's brr were. I won't go into much detail because my wife edited this, so I can't tell you like half of the stuff I was going to say, but I'll give you a little taste. So while you never heard him curse, by the way, he cursed. But while you never heard him curse, he would use a instead. So, for instance, he will tell somebody to go in your hat. He would say, you know, you're a royal pain in the... So people will look at him, what the hell did he say? But that was Tony. I have to mention Tony the comic because it was a part of his life when he said to me one day, I can probably get up there on stage and be a comedy act, right? I go, of course you can. You're funny, you're honest, and you're nuts. Of course you can go up there. You go, Anthony always said that Tony was a great storyteller. He was a great storyteller. And that's the requirement for anything in acting and comedy, whatever. But, and I said, yeah, they'll love you. He said, no, really. And I said, yeah. So Anthony, my son, he knew the owner of Caroline's, the comedy club on Broadway, and asked him if his friend Tony can perform. My son convinced him he was funny. The owner said, sure, but let him bring 25 people at the gate. And that's the game in that business. So he had to bring 25 people, which was okay because it was easy. We all came out of the woodwork and watched Tony perform his 7 minutes of stand-up routine. He was hilarious. Anecdotes of the old neighborhood, stories about advertising, politics. When Tony talked about the truth in advertising, remember this one, he didn't tell jokes, he told stories. When he was talking about truth in advertising, he would talk about what was real, and then he'd demonstrate what wasn't real by tapping his glass eye with a pen. So you can just imagine the gasps from the audience. That was worth the price of admission. When you hear click, 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 that is not real. Click, click. He did that at a client meeting once, which was amazing. But the client understood. I get it. I get it. Yeah, once again, more people got a healthy dose of Tony Romeo, the drug, and ended up feeling better for it. When Tony started his new parish year and created Reach NYC and held his Bible and a bagel morning breakfasts, he put all his talents together, his expert advertising marketing, his comedic humor, his fierce love for his religion and his God. He continued to make people feel better and make people better, talking about his God. Tony never said goodbye, by the way, on the phone. He ended every conversation, not with goodbye, but okay, Nunziata, see ya, take it easy, and God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Before I met Tony, I only said that when somebody sneezed. He taught me how to say, God bless you. He got me saying it after every conversation and every speech, like this one. See you, Toto. Go take it easy, and God bless you.
We're gonna give us a shot, Chris. Cool. All right. I'll put this over here. Joe, thank you. He would have loved to hear you, and he loved talking to you on the phone all the time. Enjoy the time spent, long deadlines, good food. He always said he wanted to have his last pastrami sandwich before he died. He didn't have it, but he had been vegetarian for a long time. He said, my last pastrami, when I'm going to have it. Let's see how this works out. I'll try to keep it together. Some of you knew him from his advertising career, while others knew him only from church. All right. Woo! To you he was Tony or Pastor Tony, but to us he was simply Poppy. What spanned Anthony Joseph Romeo's adolescence, his growth into a man, and the diverse spectrum of his career and friendships were two things that were the bedrock of his foundation: God and his family. As Chase so wonderfully put, the shape of his family changed over the years. It grew, it contracted, only to grow again. But today it has morphed once more in a yet immeasurable way. With the loss of the person who was our brother, uncle, grandfather, husband, and father. He was the keystone of our family. My father was a man whose mind was gifted, his character rich, whose passion and conviction was as strong as it was transparent, and who loved thoroughly, with an open mind and an open heart. As his family, we had the good fortune of seeing Poppy at his very best, and yes, at his worst. Through it all, he had an indomitable spirit that, in combination with our mother Marlene, has left me and my brother AJ with a bar set incredibly high with regards to the kinds of people we strive to be in our lives and in the lives of those around us. My father's character, you've heard a lot about it today, but let me add some more. Paramount to who he was his love and trust for God. My father had a deep, booming voice, but used it to share God's love in a tender-hearted way. He was generous with his time, material possessions, and his wisdom. He was caring and nurturing. My father was the ultimate storyteller and communicator. He could share a story or experience in such a way that you felt the tone of the place and visualized the scene with such clarity. His stories were infused with laughter and his humor lifted spirits. He had the humble ability to laugh at himself and all around make known his flaws first before anyone else would, often offering them up as lessons to those around him. He was self-deprecating like no other. He saw the world and observed its people with such an innovative perspective that I truly miss. He talked to anyone and spoke up just about any matter he observed, sometimes to our embarrassment. Okay, oftentimes to our embarrassment. As kids, AJ and I would tug at his arms and beg him, please, Poppy, don't say anything. But more often than not, we beamed with pride at our Poppy. My father was a natural leader, and his attention to detail and punctuality were trademarks of his professionalism. For instance, I noticed this. He would have noticed this on the floor. It's a piece of flour that was from here. That's the kind of thing he would notice. For instance, that professionalism translated into our home. At home, when we were younger, we didn't just answer the phone with, "Hey, hello." It was, "Hello, this is the Romeos. How can I help you?" On lazy Sunday mornings, he'd ask, "Why are you still in bed? Get up." My father had a constant desire to learn, grow, and understand others. In recent years, he cherished the studies he took at Blanton Peel Institute that Pastor Mazzella turned him on to, wherever you are, Pastor Mazzella, where he learned more about peers from other faith groups and the importance of caring for congregants' mental health, not just their spiritual health. He was integrity-filled and had a strong, clear sense of right versus wrong. He wasn't afraid of going against the grain or his peer group, even the Seventh-day Adventist Church at times. Simply going along with something or someone to keep the peace was certainly not his style. He had the uncanny ability to have us question all that we think we know and we're ready to accept, but ought to question and reconsider. He was an advocate for underrepresented or muffled voices, standing up for others when necessary. He shared all he was with complete transparency. You always knew his heart. It was no mystery. And if he didn't agree with you about something, he would come to you directly and tell you first, not someone else. And when he realized he hurt someone, he was the first to say sorry. He absolutely was the first to say sorry. Or if the opposite case, the first to forgive. He was innovative, intelligent, creative, and just so talented. But combined with his God-given wisdom and honesty, he was a powerhouse. My father's passion and conviction. As noted, my father had a passion for God. He wouldn't just say, "God loves you." He would say, "God is so in love with you, just as you are, warts and all." He shared his love and opened many eyes to a loving and accepting God, a God whose love is so much broader and more inclusive than all of our hearts combined. My father translated that love for God into a deep commitment to his family and his community, not just the congregants at this church, but to all neighbors in the community of which this church is a part. He was proactive. He didn't sit and wait for things to happen. He made things happen, regardless of the likelihood of success. He was willing to try things. If you guys remember this, at two different times in our childhood and in parallel with his advertising career, he took his hobbies and tried his hand at turning them into business ventures. First, he opened a small garden nursery at our home that he called Romeo Gardens. Later, on a separate occasion, he opened a toy shop in a room in our house. Let me tell you, only one person bought a toy the whole time, but he was passionate and convicted of his hobby, or in his hobby. He started the series Concerts for Peace that was intended to create new bonds with the neighborhood and showcase the talents of local and international musicians. He also tried new creative approaches to ministry. He took a chance at stand-up comedy. I want to say more, but I'll leave it at that. He encouraged and worked closely with the board of this church to invite community groups into this church with open arms and open hearts. My father was a man of strong convictions and opined about any number of topics he was passionate about, and he did it in any medium possible, as Bloody Leno described, often on Facebook and often with a lot of comments that didn't necessarily agree with his perspective. He called out nonsense and was honest in his assessments. But that was coupled with his welcoming, caring, protecting, and loving approach to his friends and acquaintances, embracing people from all walks of life, even if it was inconvenient. He embraced peoples of all race, economic status, sexual orientation, political beliefs, immigration status, and faith or non-faith backgrounds. It didn't matter. And he was trustworthy. Don't get me wrong, he was terrible about keeping secrets about certain things. For example, when he would purchase a gift for my mom, he could barely contain his excitement and would often spill the beans way before the date or the special occasion the gift was intended for. However, when it came to listening to others, sharing their concerns, and hearing about their life issues, He was like a vault. Not only to our immediate family, but to our extended family, he was the ballast and anchor. He had a sensitive soul. He recognized the joy of another person and expressed elation for them, or sensed the quiet pain in someone's experience and would cry along with them. He was generous with his tears. He would often get caught up with emotion and stand in this very place, and while speaking, need to take a moment, or two, or three, simply to compose himself because he had been touched by a thought, a song, a text, or a person's experience. He was unashamed of his tears. In his daily encounters, he was an observer and had the ability to see things from a unique perspective that few may consider. He often documented these observations by drawing humorous cartoons, or snapping a photo, or jotting down reflective commentary. And he would get excited about so many things and share it with everyone he encountered. After all, he was a kid at heart in so many ways. He had a deep appreciation for God's creation and beauty in the world. Nature, animals, people, readings, music, art, good design, he loved it all. For those that knew him well, you know he had a penchant for simple, well-designed garden tools and amassed quite a collection of hand shovels and watering cans. Yes, folks, watering cans. He also had quite a collection of antique toys and old advertising that showcased his playfulness and love of design. And his love for beauty in the world extended to bread. On countless occasions, I'm not talking about money, I'm actually talking about bread. On countless occasions for family gatherings, he would make his 6 a.m. ritual trip to Arthur Avenue in the Bronx to pick up mozzarella, various Italian delicacies, and sweets, and to, of course, pick up bread. Now, two loaves of bread would often be more than sufficient for the occasion. However, my father would come back with bags heaping with loaf upon loaf in various sizes, shapes, textures, and grain and flour composition. We exclaimed with a surprise, "Poppy, what did you do?" He slyly remarked, "But it was so beautiful, I couldn't resist." He appreciated quality, not only in well-crafted products, but also experiences, and more importantly, quality people. He expected a lot, not only from others, but from himself. We're back. Poppy always used to say, "It's live church, people. Take it easy." All right. All right. I observed and experienced all of what I've described, knowing that who my father was in large part a reflection of whose life partner was, my mother, who she is and who will continue to be. If you know them or knew them, you knew them together that their personalities were so incredibly different. Yet they were so amazingly suited for one another. Beyond their love for each other, they formed a strong bond based on their mutual love for God, their care for each other, and those around them, and love for their family. They opened their homes at any possible occasion to anyone who wanted to come over. And what a team they were, as friends, as parents, as ministry partners. Mommy, Poppy would joke that because of your physical strength, work ethic, and dedication, you were, in his words, the man I've always wanted to be. Early in their dating life, they were watching a Spanish language program, and while my father didn't understand the exact words of the commercial for the toothpaste brand called Gleam, what stuck out in his mind was the visuals and the closing tagline that promised bright white smiles with Gleam, or as the Spanish voiceover said, con Gleam. Well, with her bright, wide, unassuming smile, my father quickly adopted for my mother the nickname of Con Gleam. She was Marlene initially, then Kong Gleam, and later Mommy. Mommy, I'm so sorry that you will no longer be able to hear Poppy call out to you. In his deep baritone voice, Kong Gleam. But always remember what Poppy shared during his last week with us. When we asked him, Poppy, what are you most proud of? He answered with conviction and no hesitation, simply, Mommy. He loved you deeply. And we will continue to love and protect you as Poppy did. And while we can't promise to make you laugh as Poppy did, we'll certainly try our best. In closing, I'd like to share a brief story with you. My father was always there for all of us. I'm not talking about just his family, but a lot of you here gathered today, even when it became clear that he didn't have much time left. About a month after his terminal cancer diagnosis, I was scheduled to take the last of 7 tests in pursuit of my architecture license. Up to that point, I had taken all of my exams in New York City, but due to a scheduling snafu, I had to take my last exam in Westchester County in the absence of public transportation. And of course, Poppy offered to take me. After much back and forth, I relented, and on the morning of the exam, we stepped into the car and embarked towards the testing center. For those that follow my father's posts on Facebook, I miss them so much, don't you? You will know this story. Allow me to share it again. He wrote on April 12th the following, and I quote, "This past Monday, I was driving with my daughter Jennifer on I-684 South to an appointment she had. A large, white, beautiful truck passed us on our right, with topography that was a classic design reminiscent of the masthead of the New York Times, a lovely black typeface on white. Florence Casket Company was tastefully centered on the back panel of the truck. I told her, it was a sign from God. We both laughed. Later that same afternoon, while driving her to the train station after her last test for her architecture license, we stopped for a red light and noticed the license plate on the back of this gleaming red Cadillac. We both laughed once again at this sign, or as I always refer to these kinds of encounters as a wink from God. It said, have faith. And this is the exact picture of what we took on that day. My father closes his note by sharing, 4 hours had passed since reading the back of the Florence Casket Company truck. Just a coincidence? I've seen God wink at me many times. Keep those winks coming." End quote. So, to his friends, church family, acquaintances, and to my family, I'd like to believe that that wink was not just for my father or me on that day. It was a wink to each of us, long after we step out of the doors of this church today. Have faith that the kindnesses of my father offered, the stories he shared, the smiles he put on our faces, the lessons he taught, and the wisdom he imparted will always serve as a beacon in our lives. Have faith that we don't need a personality like my father to have an equal effect on those we meet. We can each love deeply and touch the lives of those around us, as my father tried his best to do. And finally, have faith that while Anthony Joseph now rests, we will see him once again. I can't wait to see Poppy, one of my best friends, again. We love you, Poppy. Thank you.
There's a big company that makes these and a small one that makes these. Why would they both do business with IBM? Well, the company that makes these wants a computer company big enough to get them where they want to go. Bon voyage, kiddo. And the company that makes these needs a company with an eye for the smallest details. Small businesses have big reasons for calling IBM. Big businesses even have small reasons to call IBM. But smart businesses have every reason to call IBM.
When I bite into a York peppermint patty, I get a sensation that, well, I'm just glad I get a sensation.
York peppermint patty, get the sensation.
The cookies gone into Hershey's Cookies and Cream. A mouthful of cookies in every bite.
What is this?
Well, what?
Deli style lays. And who gave you permission to use the word deli?
Permission?
Deli isn't a word you just throw around. Don't you understand all the cutting, the slicing, the carving it takes to make a thick, wonderful deli sandwich?
Yeah, but
and
I
this,
was...
This is deli.
Hearty, crispy, new deli-style Lay's.
At Michelin, we believe a tire that's just good in the rain isn't good enough. Introducing the X1. It gives you better wet traction than any rain tire, plus control in any weather. After all, it hasn't rained that much in years. The Michelin X1.
At Cigna, we care about people who have babies. We care about people who have cancer. We care about companies that make steel. And about companies that make bread. We care about people whose lives have been shattered and the people who help pick up the pieces. We care about life. And about all that makes life great or possible or just better. At Cigna, we care because it is our business to care, and because the more we care, the better our business does. But we also care because, well, because we have babies, too. Cigna, a business of caring.
Please welcome Tony Romeo, everybody!
So, I'm very happy to be here tonight. I give a warning to the first row. It's High of the Handicap night, and I have a glass eye. So I give a little warning in the front row in case it falls out. A little sound check first. I give him one of these. It's very real. Is everybody okay? Don't feel sorry for me. I think everyone in New York City should get at least one eye removed from their head. I have no problem getting a seat in the subway. You know, I walk right in, look around, you know, guy gets up, holy mackerel, I sit right down, it's no big deal, no big deal. I go to meetings, right, and people deny I have a glass eye, you know, this new world of text messaging, you know, I tell them I have a glass eye, say, well, you have a glass eye, I have no idea you have a glass eye, you know, you have a glass eye, really, I can't believe it, let me see, which one? I mean, meanwhile, they're all, during the meeting when I'm giving the lecture, they're all text messaging each other, you know? Look at the guy. I think he's got a glass eye. Which one? I'm not sure. I think he's got one on the left. I'm not sure. But, you know, I know what's going on. I'm not a jerk. The other thing is, New Yorkers are always in a rush, right? Like tonight, you know, everybody's in a rush, going here, going there. I don't rush anymore. I'm too old to rush. I'll be dead soon enough, you know what I'm saying? I take my time wherever I go. But in the shower in the morning, people are always in a rush. They're taking a shower. They soap up your body, right? And when you drop the soap, people are kind of lazy in this city, right? You drop the soap and you say, you know, do I really have to wash the rest of my body? I washed enough. I got one armpit at least, you know? But you kind of debate, do I have to bend down now and pick up the soap? So I didn't wash anything else in my body. What's the big deal? But when your glass eye falls in the bathtub there, and you're kind of drunk, you kind of look at it, you're not quite sure, am I looking at the eye? Is the eye looking at me? You don't know what's going on. You have no idea what's going on here. Ridiculous.
Hi. Well, I'm driving myself to heaven because in this world, if you want it done right, you gotta do it yourself. Evidently, if you're listening to this video, I've died. Oh, I know, don't cry. I'm fine. I don't even know what's going on right now. But if you're having a good time at the church with my family, God bless you. I know Marlene's been cooking for at least several days. Have a good time eating. Don't forget to chew. It's been a great time knowing most of you. You guys are all I love. I love each one of you. And depending on our theology, whether I'm right or wrong, I'm either in heaven or sleeping or somewhere in purgatory if our Catholic friends are right. Anyway, have a good time. I'll see you at some day when Christ comes again. Love you. Bye-bye.
I want to thank each of you and every one of you for coming again tonight. I appreciate it. I'm going to be doing the reading from 1 Corinthians 13. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection in a mirror. Then we shall see the face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love.
It was not easy at all coming up with one piece of music for Tony Romeo. We all have innumerable, indelible memories of Tony and music. Tony singing to music, Tony crying to music, and Tony offering eloquent homage to the rich and fragrant and endless common ground that music offers. Music, the ultimate language that doesn't know anything about boundaries or walls or barriers. So finally, we did come up with something. We would end every year at Advent Hope during our years together singing a song. And we ended the year singing this song that asks this question. How do you measure a year in the life? How about love? Remember the love. This is Seasons of Love from Rent, from a joint group from Advent Hope and Manhattan Church.
Thank you, each of you, for joining us today. It's remarkable to see each of you here. I don't know all of who you are, so I hope at some point we can talk to each other and get to know each other better as my father knew you, or as you knew my father. I'd like to thank so many of the people who contributed today to make this such a remarkable experience. I appreciate your encouragement and prayers during this time. And to you, the people who are here with us, the participants, the persons who contributed their time, efforts to the service, thank you so much for helping to celebrate our father, brother, friend, Tony. We're so grateful for your friendship, and we're hoping that it doesn't end here. Also, I know many of you want to share music or words or up here. Unfortunately, we didn't have the time, but we're hoping that you can share your remembrances, anecdotes, stories, photos, and a remembrance book that we'd like to put together. In your program, there's an email address, rememberingtonyromeo@gmail.com. Please share your stories through that, and we'd like to document it and pull it into a book in the very near future. Again, thank you so much. My father didn't want to have a memorial service, and he did this more for us, or he allowed us to do this more for us than for him. He didn't think anyone would show up. So thank you. He loved each of you so much. And every time I see somebody, I tell them, oh my goodness, my father loved you so much. And I tell that time and time again to so many people because it's true. He loved so much. And he loved each of you so much. Thank you. And please join us for refreshments downstairs. Thank you.
May I ask you to stand as we close in prayer? Our God and Father, we thank you for bringing us together here tonight. We thank you for having given us Tony. We thank you and praise you for his life, a life well lived, a life built based on you. We thank you for today. We can afford to mourn without lamenting, to cry without despair, to smile, laugh, and remember. As we exit the doors of this building, be with us through your Spirit. Speak to us. Impress our minds and our hearts. Allow us to understand that you are God and that we need you. Allow us to surrender our lives unto your hands, to allow you to save us. Allow us, Lord, to measure life, years, and seasons by the way you do measure us, through love. May we love one another, and may we love you. For if we can't love our neighbor, whom we can see, how could we ever love you that we can't see yet? Help us to live that love in our lives. And until that day when we'll see you in the clouds of heaven, keep us close to you. Keep us blessed. In Jesus' name, amen.